next speaker, Tobias Lage. Tobias is a professor at MIT in the Sloan School of Management. And one of the really killer applications that's emerged on the interface of computer science and economics in the past 2 years has been market design and matching problems, and in particular, continuing exchange. And Tobias is one of the young scientists doing very exciting work in that area. I'm very happy that we have him here in the summer school.
So I'll have two topics. One is going to be kidney exchange, but it's going to be the second topic tomorrow. I'll talk a little bit about matching, stable matching, and an application, the National Residency Matching Program, and some work. Part of it is also work that I did recently. Tomorrow will be the kidney exchange stuff. So let's start with a little bit of background about this market for the U.S. medical resident market. So in recent years, at least, this market is growing over time. And in recent years, these are pretty much the numbers. So you see, this is, I think, numbers from 2011. These are approximate numbers, about 16,000 graduates from the U.S. Medical school. There's other students from foreign countries that also apply for residency programs. But these are pretty much this is pretty much the size, and usually in those residencies programs, there's priorities to people from the U.S. department. So in general, when we'll model this, we'll actually assume that there's more positions than slots in more positions than graduate students. Take into account that those priorities are for just for graduate students, for U.S. students. So here's how it works, and there's lots of matching mechanisms that work like this in practice. So you want to, there's labor market or this NRMP market. There's these students here, Alice, Bob, and Charlie, and there's the residency programs. And each one has preferences on the other side. So Alice prefers program one and then program two. This school prefers Alice, then Bob, and then Charlie. So they list strict preference relation. And here in the black box, what's going to run is going to run some matching algorithms. So that is going to take into account those preferences. Okay? So, and it's going to spit out some match. So this match is going on from around the 50s, and it turns out that what's running is this is, by the way, how it looks like. There's a single day Thursday in March that everybody gets the results. You put in your preferences. There's a computerized algorithm that spits out the match, and everybody sees it at the same time. It's kind of interesting that, especially in a country like U.S., this is how it's organized, and you can't really go and talk to who you're going to work with. There are some interviews before that, and you cannot interview with the entire market. There's just a small range of time that you can interview, like about 2 months, and you can't fly all the country between all the residency programs. So you interview with some of them, but at some point you have to. There's a deadline to submit your preferences, and there's a day that this computer is running. Okay. So what the algorithm that runs in practice is an algorithm that is looking for a stable match. What is a stable match? A stable match is one that if you got your third preference, it means that you cannot get your first or second preference because they like someone better than you. That's what they got. They're assigned to someone they like better than you. Okay, so in this case, we have those residency programs. And so here, if Bob is assigned to the first program, Charlie to the second program, and so forth, and you can see easily that this is a stable match because every program got their first preference. Okay, so if a stable match is not going to be stable, if there is a pair of school and a student who prefer to leave their own their matches, their assigned matches, and go together. Okay? So the algorithm that we used to run in practice, and a version of it is still running in practice, is the doctor proposing deferred acceptance algorithm. This version was written by was proposed by Gale and Shapley in '62. In fact, a very similar version was run even before that, and it's not surprising. It's a very natural algorithm. How it works is that after you submit your preferences, they take your preferences, and if you're students, according to your preferences, you apply to the first preference. And the hospitals that get applications are rejecting everyone but the best choice they got so far, the best application they have, so everybody is rejected. And they keep this best choice temporarily, and everybody applies to their second preference. Those who've been rejected apply to the second preferences. And now if I'm a hospital and I get a better application than the one that I kept, I'm rejecting all those that I don't like, I'm keeping always the best choice, and that's how it goes on. So students always apply according to their preferences, as long as they're rejected, and this algorithm will end because eventually either you're not rejected or you reach the bottom of your preferences. Okay, so it really simulates what you would do in practice if you had all the time in the world. Okay, you would go to your first choice and then to your second choice and so forth. And all the hospitals what the hospitals are doing are just rejecting and keeping temporarily the best choice all the time. Okay, so this is a doctor proposing deferred acceptance. You can do the opposite. Your schools can propose and so forth. And it has very nice properties. One is stability. What I mentioned. Another nice property is that it's dominant strategies for the dominant strategy to tell your true preferences as a student. It's not strategy proof, unfortunately for the hospitals. And it provides a best stable match for each doctor point wise. Okay, so in fact the set of stable matchings is a lattice. And the best stable match point was for the students if the students propose. Okay, so for stability is you can easily prove this. It's just by the nature of the algorithm. Okay, you'll just apply according to your preferences, and if it's not stable that for some of you, then it means that there's some hospital is willing to accept you, but that you like better. But you apply to that hospital, and the only reason that it rejected you is because it got on doing the algorithm a better application. Okay, and you can prove also quite easily using simple inductions that it's safe for applicants to report truthfully, for students to report truthfully, and I won't get into that. And also the lattice is also it's not a difficult proof, but. But these are the references. Why stability? You can think about why not do some other matching algorithms. And here's just some empirical result or real markets that use stable mechanisms, ones that produce stable outcomes, and some that are not, and you see pretty much that there's very high correlation between those centralized markets that still exist and use stable mechanisms. Some of them did use in the past non-stable mechanism and moved to stable mechanism. And part of the reason, there's a lot of literature about this, but part of the reason is, for example, if I'm not matching to someone that is stable, I might go look for somewhere else. So those competitive markets, and things that if it's not stable, for example, things like unraveling can start happening, lots of phenomena that lots of people wrote about, but eventually this is giving you a clear evidence that why stability is very important. You can also let the markets just run by themselves and see what happens, but. One advantage is for centralized markets is that you can really take all this time and do it at once instead of letting people start and talk to every possible employer in the market. Yes?
Can you So there are two of those on your slide on the still in use comment that suggests that someone who was using a stable system was switching to an unstable one recently or something. What's the medical specialties and dental residences?
The first one?
No, the second column has two dates. Yeah.
Ah, this one?
Yeah.
They're switching to a no. So I'm not sure about this one.
Or there are two of them. You have any understanding of why they're switching away from a good system to a bad system?
So I don't know about these exactly, but I know, for example, one of the markets. I forgot the name of this profession. It's a medical profession, but they switch to a to something that doesn't work. Some of the reason can be like efficiency. Not every stable allocation is efficient, and some you have people who complain. If the market is small, then it's easy to come up with other proposals and try them. You can. And so forth. But usually I don't. So I know about, for example, that in this, forgot the name of this. So anyway, there's a market that went to a non-stable mechanism, and and went back to a stable one. They saw clearly that it doesn't work. And in fact, for example, for the lawyers, it's not listed here. There's still not a centralized market. So not for lawyers, for clerks. People who finish to study law school and need to go to do a clerkship. So it turns out they're trying to build a mass centralized mechanism. And what happens there is that judges are starting to offer students already in the first year because they want the best students. So they first offered people who finished in third year, but it went back to offer students second year and first year. And no, the judges are not able to agree to have just a centralized market. So it's not easy to get everybody to agree to move to a centralized system. You think you're the best judge out there and you just want the best student. I don't know. We don't know yet much there's some results about when is a stable matching is needed and or a centralized matching mechanism is needed versus just leave it the market to operate by itself. There's not much evidence. Unraveling people talked about, but what characterizes exactly when we need a centralized market or not is an important problem. I think part of it has to do with probably the size of the market, but we don't know much about this. So here's an example for a mechanism that assigns students to schools. It's called the Boston School Choice Mechanism. And they're not using this anymore. But how this mechanism works is everybody submits their preferences. Every student submits their preferences. Schools only consider, in the first round, every school considers only those that listed them as the top choice and starts filling in students, but they're not going to reject them either. And then students who don't have a place in that school, it's overcapacitated, they're going to apply to the next school. And that school already might be, and now they've been considered, but after the students that have already been considered in that next school. So if what's going to happen here is that if I apply to my top choice might be full, and then I go to the second choice, and that already have been full because it was already being filling in the first round, and I might get down very low to my very worst school. Parents and families were complaining a lot about this mechanism. They were trying to, of course, there's actually quite some work about this now, but trying to manipulate the system, and so not all parents are thinking about how to game the system. A lot of parents did game the system, but it's not safe to participate in this market. And the Boston School Choice was redesigned to be a deferred acceptance algorithm where students apply. So this is it's a really nice evidence, and there's been a lot of work, what will happen in equilibrium in the Boston School Choice mechanism and things like that. But this is a very nice example for a mechanism that changed to be stable. And it turns out that stability and efficiency don't go together. For example, there's ties. If I'm a school and I have ties over the students, I don't have strict preferences, then you can find cycles that can improve. Maybe I want to switch, two students want to switch with each other. They just got assigned to who they are matched to just by chance because of the, they applied, one of them applied first. So what happens in practice is that, how do they run those mechanisms? There's a chart here.
If you just look behind
the what?
Behind the blackboard.
If you slide up the blackboard, there's a
Okay. So one way when, for example, in Boston, in elementary schools, schools don't have still preferences over students. Okay, in high schools in New York, they do have preferences. But so in, will you run a deferred acceptance, for example? Or the Boston school choice mechanism, you will run, for example, what they do in practice is you randomize priorities for schools over students. Okay, and if the school preferred me over someone else, then I was just lucky to be there, but maybe, and maybe I got just the wrong assignment, or that you got the wrong assignment, and we can still switch and be both of us better off. Yes?
When you say high school in New York have preferences, do they submit explicit rankings?
Or they submit explicit
by some grades and exams?
They submit explicit rankings. Yeah. They don't list all the students, but so students, for example, submit just a list of 12 schools in New York, but students and schools submit. I don't think they submit all the, not all the students. Maybe those that don't submit, maybe there's ties or something. Yeah. But basically, they do submit preferences. I'm not sure how. So what can happen when there's ties on the, for example, on the school side? It can be inefficient, and you can find those what's called stable improvement cycles. Okay. So again, if by chance you got a better priority or get a than me, but maybe we can still switch or find a cycle that everybody, all of us are better. And that led to the question whether stability and efficiency don't go together, but it turns out that you cannot do much better than the deferred acceptance algorithm. So there's no stable strategy proof mechanism that temporarily dominates deferred acceptance. And this is a nice work that deals with all these ties, and they also dealt with this. And Azevedo and Leshner recently provided an example for a mechanism that if you report truthfully, you're going to dominate the deferred acceptance outcome, but all equilibria are going to be already dominant. So right now we're in a position that deferred acceptance is the only stable proof, strategy proof stable mechanism, is what we know how to do. There is some evidence that you can still, there's in this work, in the Kudrovoglu et al., there's evidence that there's still lots of stable improvement cycles, but you cannot really achieve them if you start considering behavior of students. So under equilibria, you might be worse off. Okay, so, I might get into this later, but let's go back to the National Residency Matching Program. So far I said, okay, there's the deferred acceptance algorithm, and it always produces a stable matching, given that each one of us is an individual, and we have indeed preferences over the schools, and schools have residency programs, and residency programs have preferences over the students. Okay, and then with respect to that, there's a stable matching. So what happened over the years is that more and more women started to go to medical school, and men and women put them together and they start interacting and they might be couples. And then there's couples who are interested in finding jobs and they want to be in, for example, in the same city, or they want some They're not just looking for one job separate, each one separate. Okay, so there's some complementarities going on. Okay? So what happened in practice is that in those years between the 70s and the 80s, the participation in the matching program by couples has started to drop down. Why? Because it didn't let couples express their preferences. They wanted to list. They had preferences over couples of jobs, two jobs in Boston and two jobs in or the same hospital and things like that. Okay, or Boston and New York and so forth. So they started to feel bad and started to talk to hospitals directly and find jobs not with the match. Yeah.
So it's not exactly
the
individual talking to the hospitals.
It was what?
They started individually talking to the
hospitals. Yeah, so that's what happened. They were not happy with this and starting to find jobs directly. There's more and more rules getting into the, if you go to the NRMP website, there's more and more rules that have been added over the year. Those rules come because some things happen, but for example, you're not allowed to tell in an interview, if I'm going to offer you, are you going to come to me? And, but it still happens. So these rules are, so there's lots of rules there, but these things happen. People's, and before that, those rules were some of the rules, those kind of rules were not written, and that's what's happening. Okay, and in 98, Roth and Pearson wrote a different algorithm. They updated the deferred acceptance algorithm to allow couples to express their preferences. There was nothing proved about this algorithm, but it turns out that since it was adopted in 99 till today, every year, at least with respect to the reported preferences, there was a stable match. Okay, since then. So I won't mention exactly what this algorithm is doing. I'll talk about a different algorithm we're proposing, which is very closely related. Okay. So here's how couples' preferences are expressed, at least today in the mechanism. So if Alice and Bob are a couple, you can list pairs of hospitals. You list pairs of hospitals. So New York City A, New York City X, and you repeat themselves. You can repeat some hospitals because you. Okay. In fact. There's this book called The Match, just about this thing, and there's lots of stories of people who, for example, had to decide if they are we really a couple before we go to the match, or things like that. It's a serious thing, right? Careers. It's interesting to look at. But, okay, so here's the number of couples in the match. Every year, and now it's about 800 couples among the U.S. students, about 16,000 graduates again, and it grows. This is the evidence.
Yeah, the question.
Yeah.
I didn't follow why you might want to repeat the hospital.
So here. So if you don't, if Bob doesn't get into X, I still want to go to A, and maybe.
So is it that the couple submits one ranking together and they don't individually submit a ranking anymore?
So they can choose if to be a, first of all, you can also choose if to be a couple, but once you decided to be a couple as in the match, you submit pairs of hospitals and they can repeat because I still want A if you get to X or if you get to Y.
And is it ordered in the sense that do Alice and Bob care whether Alice gets MIC A and Bob gets MIC X? Or Alice gets MICX and Bob gets
MICA.
Does that matter?
No, this is Alice, then this is Bob. Yeah.
Right.
It is ordered.
Okay.
Yeah. Question? Yeah.
But who can claim the couple? Do they need to be married?
No, so anyone can be a couple.
I know some people who got married because they thought it would improve their chances.
So you don't have to be, anybody can be a couple. There's an internship centralized program we're looking at now in Israel, And over there, you actually almost also have to prove that the wife is pregnant to have, but that's easy to prove, or at least happy. Well, sometimes it's hard to prove, depends what month you are. Or have a kid, and then you can participate as a couple. But here, everybody can participate. And there's a little bit of results about whether you want to participate as a couple or not. You can easily show that sometimes you want to manipulate and be a couple, sometimes not. And you can easily come up with examples.
That was my question. Did you ever want to basically say you're a couple when you're actually...
So you can come up with those examples. They're not very, so far, they're not very interesting ones. On small markets, you can come up with them. But So first, the first question is, does there exist a stable match? And you can, there's complementarities going on here, and you can show easily, here's a very simple example. This example is by Klaus and Klein, Rothel, and he showed them a more complex example, more a bigger example that there's no stable match when there's couples in the market. So here we have two residency programs, one couple and one single. Okay, and those are the preferences. And you, by the way, and you don't have to list everybody. Okay, so some, if they list one and two, this is the only pair that are willing to go to. Every other pair, the other combination, they don't want to be matched. Yeah.
So, what is the adaptation of the deferred acceptance algorithm for the pairs?
So, how is it done today?
Yeah. So you go to couple law and then. First choice.
So what happens in practice is they apply, if a couple is rejected, it goes to some stack, and then it will reapply again, so later on. I'll give you a different algorithm, which I think is the... Nobody analyzed that one, but the one that runs now, but I think it's equivalent, and I think that's an open question, but I think it's, at least for large market, I think it's equivalent. But it's closely related to what I'll show you soon. Yeah?
So in this example, they don't have full preferences, but do we know if
you don't have to? So in practice, you're not going to have full preferences because you're going to list only those that you interviewed with, mm-hmm. and you cannot interview with thousands of or hundreds of residency programs.
Well, so I'm wondering if there are no couples and just partial preferences. Do we know that there's a stable match in that?
With respect to that, so no, this is partial preferences, and I'm going to, if there's full preferences, you're asking.
No, so I'm asking no couple.
No, so
but partial preferences.
No, there's always a stable match. Even so, partial preferences when for singles means that the last guys are not acceptable. The same argument that to show that there's a stable match in the third acceptance would work. You just stop. You're just not matched. So okay. You sometimes prefer not to be matched than to be matched with someone.
Okay.
But yes. Yeah. Okay. So singles, everything is okay. So here, so let's see to see that there's no stable matching. We can just check it, right? We can put the couple here, but then. So C and Charlie and the second residency program are a blocking, what's called a blocking pair. Okay, so they prefer to go together. And so two residency program prefers to throw Bob and take Charlie. And Charlie's not matched, he prefers to go to two, so he's here. But notice that when they're blocking pair, both Alice and Bob have to leave. But Alice cannot stay here because she didn't list, they could have listed one and I'm not, and this one is not matched, but they didn't list that. Okay, so they both have to leave. And you can keep on checking now. Charlie prefers to move to residency program one because it's empty and he prefers being there. And now the couple is back to the picture. Okay, so now the couple is preferred. The residency programs prefer Alice and Bob instead of Charlie. Okay, so this is probably the most simple example, and you see what happens here. The difficulty is there's kind of a cycle going on. Okay, if you continue this, this is what's going to happen. We're going to. Okay, so as I mentioned, in the last 12 years, the stable match has been found. And there's been few failures in other markets that have, like other medical markets and things like that, that have couples involved. In the psychology market, for example, it was a much smaller market, and there was just a couple of failures in the last 9 years, I think, or 7 years. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to model this. This is a large market, and I'm going to model this as a large market and show that at least in large markets, things are working well. So, and we're going to propose an algorithm that finds a stable matching in those algorithms. So, here's the model. So, there's n doctors. There's n to the 1 minus epsilon couples in this market. So n is what's going to grow. There's lambda in residency spots, and there's going to be a fraction of residency spots larger than available. And part of the reason for that is we're going to allow that students have full preferences. You can do it differently by having partial preferences. I list only those that are interviewed with, and I list just a constant number of people I interview with. And then if you don't have extra residency spots, you're going to get extra residency spots by using probability arguments, because some residency spots are going to be left over. Yes?
So in the example you just showed us, there were only 2 residency spots for 3 markets. The example where the couple matching failed.
Yeah.
So in this case, where you're saying that the number of residency spots is always 3,
you can still find an example there. Yeah, I can add. I could have added a bunch of slots that nobody wants, right? Okay. So this is the model. So and there's a bunch of slots for each hospital. It's a constant number. Okay. And we're going to have random preferences and. For in this work, this is supposed, we're not going to assume that it comes roughly from a uniform distribution. Okay, there might be some weights, but how you draw the preferences, but roughly, no hospital is infinitely more better than other than some other hospital. Okay, and I think this is something that is interesting to break in the future result, to look at also more geographical preferences and things like that. And hospitals have arbitrary preferences. They can have them. Okay, then.
And the preferences are independent of each other?
What?
The doctor's preferences?
Independent, yes. And for couples, you do pretty much the same. You randomize for the male, for the female, and then you can aggregate any way you want, as long as it respects the preferences that are drawn, okay? The order. So anything, any aggregation is allowed after you draw for each one of the members of the couple. So Kojima, Patak, and Roth started to work on this problem, and they found that they proposed an algorithm, and they showed that if the number of couples is smaller than square root n in the market, then there's their algorithm will, a stable matching will be found with probability converging to 1. Okay? And also you can show that reporting truthfully is going to be approximated Bayes-Nash equilibrium. Yes?
Just to be clear, the truthfulness result is when you have full preferences on the doctor's side, there's no unacceptable partners?
So say it again.
So in this, for this theorem, you have full preferences and don't allow for unacceptable partners, correct?
But you can allow this. But yeah, here everybody has full preferences.
But as soon as you start allowing for unacceptable, okay, never mind. Sorry, I was getting mixed up with something else.
Okay. Yeah.
Is there any evidence as to how fast the probability goes to 1, or just goes to 1? Asymptotically.
Evidence how it goes, how it grows?
Yeah, like does it go, yeah, how quickly?
So it's evidence you're talking about?
Like theory.
Theory, okay, so we have, so This one goes very slow. You can look at their work, but I'll give a. I'm going to talk more about the work that I'm involved that continued this, and I'm not going to give you convergence, but it's faster than this one, but it's still not very. I'll give some simulations. Yeah.
Is it important that aggregation respects individual rankings? So I think if my wife's top choice is in California and mine is in Boston, then maybe the first place we would apply to, I would also go to California or something like that, and the individual rankings would be.
So we're not doing that, but that would be interesting to mean conditional preferences. If the one of the spouses is draw California, then so that would be interesting to go to, I think.
What if you have like capacities for each hospital? I mean, for each hospital I, you can match B sub I residences. Yeah. Doctors, can you do the same thing, like, you know, run it in phases? So you can match more than one doctor to each hospital.
So we're allowing, there's a capacity for each hospital.
Oh.
So capacity can be more than one. It's a constant number.
But this works.
Yes.
So the number of couples in the market is increasing over time?
It is increasing in the last 30 years or so. So this is the number of couples in the market. So it's about 300, or now it's around 800. So it is increasing. So 99. But up to somewhere here, number of couples, that more and more couples started to
not to
participate, right?
Does it look for same-sex couples too? Same-sex couples?
Yes. It allows.
But how does this compare to your square root n? What fraction of the total market is this?
Yeah.
So what's the fraction? So the I don't remember exactly the number, but over here it's 800 from 16,000. Okay, so about 5%. That's a good question about the beginning. I think it grows, but I'm not sure it grows fast. It did grow, but I'm not sure how fast.
Right.
What?
Just growth,
but
then it grows to the
no, I don't have the numbers of how many participated altogether.
But also it's not clear.
That you have to be a couple.
Or that you can be a couple, right? Perhaps not all couples.
Here you don't even know. Yeah, that's right.
So
that's a good point.
The data might be.
Yes.
Down.
That's right. Yeah.
So this is the number of couples?
So from here it's pretty reliable. And some people also didn't want to be couples. But what is your question?
So this is the
number of people that participated in couples.
Okay.
Yeah. It's not number of couples, it's number that participated. Okay. So this is, I'll get back to mention, so this is the result, and I'll go further. We'll talk about something, we'll talk about when there's not necessarily square root, but n to the 1 minus epsilon. Yes.
So the conversion, so maybe an interesting special case is where residents have random preferences, but hospitals have, there's a true ranking of residents according to their qualities, and all hospitals have the same ranking over residents.
So that would be easy to solve.
So is that written?
That would be easy, yeah. If everybody agrees on rankings, the top guy gets the first. With couples you mean? I think even that is not true. So I think there's a lot of work to do here with different kinds of preferences, not random. Maybe random, but different, not uniform. So this is all almost uniform. So this is what I'm going to show, and so even if there's up to n to 1 minus epsilon couples, then the probability to find a stable matching when the market grows is 1, is going to 1. And so this, and we find it using this algorithm that I'll present. And other nice properties of deferred acceptance still hold. Okay. So we'll show the stability thing. We'll talk about the stability thing. But okay. And in fact, this result is tight. If you have a linear number of couples, then there's a constant probability not to find a stable match. Okay. And I'll mention also a little bit about the proof of this result. So it's kind of a characterization or a threshold. Okay. So we don't have much. We don't have much positive results with complementarities, and I think this is. I'll actually talk about this a little bit later. But this is a positive result in this sense, at least for large markets. So here's the. Let's start with the first result with the this n to the 1 minus epsilon couples, the sublinear now. Okay. So what we're going to do is start with a deferred acceptance algorithm, just for with the single guys. You find a stable outcome. And we want to start letting couples, one by one, applying. And if things are going well and no couple is ever going to be rejected somehow, then we're good. Okay? So if this process, if you do this, you start with the singles, and then couples are applying, nobody has ever, every couple before that is rejected, you find a stable matching. Okay? Just before the same arguments as for the deferred acceptance with singles. Okay? Okay, so what can go wrong is exactly the example that we saw before, right? The single starts applying, and this is actually a very, this is the very bad example that you have to deal with, but it's not going to happen with high probability. So the single applies, and then the couple comes in. So he rejects Charlie. That's okay so far. The single can be, we're going to allow singles to be rejected. They can still go and apply. But the problem is that Charlie is back, and he's going to evict them. So this can happen. What we're trying to, look for is an order of the couples that if they apply, no one ever before that is rejected. That's what we're going to look for. And that's going to happen with the high probability. Okay, so so this is just what I said, and what we're going to build is kind of a couples graph or an inference graph, and here's the idea. So in this graph, nodes are going to be couples. So this is couple one, couple two, and so forth, and we're going to draw a link. An edge from a couple to a couple, if potentially it's going to, if there's some good chance that it's going to evict that couple in some circumstance. Okay, so here, for example, we saw this kind of, this Charlie and Alice and Bob evicted Charlie from some hospital, but Charlie evicted Bob, which caused the couple to be evicted. So in the couple's graph, in this case, it's just going to be this one node, which is the couple, and there's going to be a link to itself. The definition of the couple's graph is going to be that there's going to be a link to a couple if there is some rejection chain that couple one caused to evict couple two. So when I apply, I'm going to cause couple two to be rejected. In this case, when the couple Alice and Bob apply to somewhere, they started a rejection chain that causes themselves to get evicted. Yeah.
Sorry, but this possibility of rejection depends also on the preferences of the singles, right?
Yes.
But they're not captured in the network at all.
So they're not
captured. This graph is just a graph of couples.
It's going to be, yeah.
And a link is made whenever there's a strictly positive chance, or is that definition of mean, or is it?
It's going to be in an adversarial way, but yes. Yeah. So it's going to depend, we construct it depending on the hospital's preferences, which are arbitrary, are given. Okay? So let's see, I'll get a little bit into how we construct it. Okay? But so let's see, this is, if this is the couple's graph, then we're, so not the couples graph. If this is the graph, so couple A and B, are, if they, when they apply, they can potentially reject single C, which can potentially reject single D. So what I mean by this potentially reject, when I apply to some hospital, this hospital preferred maybe A over C. C went somewhere else to apply. That hospital preferred him over D. And the next hospital that D is applying to prepared D's over EF. Okay, so these capture rejection chains. And in this case, there's a cycle, and the couples graph is going to look like this. Okay, so EF can potentially start a rejection chain when we'll reject AB and vice versa. Yeah.
In larger graphs, is this for a particular ordering of putting the couples in, or for all ordering?
It will be for all orderings. So what we're going to show basically is that that those cycles, we're going to create this graph, and we're going to show that those cycles don't have, there's no cycles in this couples graph with hypermobility. That's going to be the argument. Okay. So this is the graph, because that is caused by those potential rejection chains. Okay? And what's this, what's the, now we can say what the algorithm is going to be, we're going to put the singles inside, and we're going to look for some insertion order such that nobody else is ever rejected. Okay, so if we're going to build basically the couples graph. So each time a couple is evicted, I know who is evicting, and I can draw a link to that couple. And so suppose these are the evictions, I know I can construct from this an order which couple is going to apply first. So you just topological sort this, and you're good to go. Okay, so this will lead to two different kinds of orders that the couples can apply to. Okay, so when you run the algorithm, you can build this couples graph. And so here's the algorithm. You start with the singles, and you start with some order of the couples that are going to apply one by one. And if for example, couple AB evicts CD, I'm going to move CD to apply just one place ahead of AB. And rerun this again. Okay, so this is how I'm sorting, basically. And if at some points the couples graph contains a cycle, we fail. In practice, it could be still that there's a stable matching. Even if there's a cycle, you can still run. But for the analysis, this is enough. Okay? Questions about the algorithm? Okay. So what happened, the analysis in practice, I just say where the first, that a couple is going to influence a different couple with probability approximately 1 over n. And you can see here already that why the result of Patako-Jima and Roth will hold. If there's less than square root n couples, and I'm looking at a graph where every link is probability 1 over n, then there's not going to be cycles with probability 1. There's not going to be even a link with probability 1. Okay, so you have less than square root n cycles. Every one of them is with probability less 1 over n, so there's not going to be even, so no couple is even going to influence some other couple. So potentially not going to reject any other couple. Okay, so But I think what's really interesting is to find those in, to allow those interactions or those influences, but only avoid the cycles that are the real bottleneck in the system. Okay? So here's how we construct the coupled graph. So we start with this influence tree. So there's the parameter zero over there that is, let's avoid for now this, just there's a set of, the influence tree of the couple CI is going to be the set of hospitals and doctor pairs that couple I can possibly affect when he's applying as the first couple. Okay, so affect means that I can, if I'm applying now to my first choice, maybe I can get it, so I'm affecting some other doctor in that hospital, that some doctor that applied there before me and now he's rejected or something. Okay, so all the singles, because I'm the first one to apply, all the singles and the pairs of singles hospital that I can potentially reject. Okay, so suppose we have this couple in this in I's influence tree, and this couple in J's influence tree. That means that, for example, when I applies to H, he's potentially rejecting D, because maybe D was there before that. Okay, so C and D is in CI's influence tree, and H and D prime is in CJ's influence tree. But now this kinds of the preferences of H give me kind of an order where I want to put the link from which couple to which other couple. So H prefers D over D prime. So I prefer to, I'm going to have a link from CI to CJ, just to avoid that if CJ applied first, then and CI second, and CI maybe got this place, then CJ maybe got this place. I don't want CJ to be kicked out now, or this one of those doctors. So one of those doctors can be the member of the couple, for example. Okay. So this order between, again, these doctors can be members of the couples, and I do want to let you apply first if you have a better, if you're probably higher in the ranking of that hospital in order to avoid that you're being rejected. Okay? So that's how we define the influence trees, and you keep on defining this and we allow some, there's some parameter R that is gonna be how many adversarial rejections we are now in the system. Okay, so adversarial means that here that if I apply somewhere and I'm supposed to get it, maybe I'm now counting one adversarial not to get this because maybe some other doctor got there, applied there and got this position. And so I'm doing this in an adversarial way. That's how I'm building the influence trace.
So can you explain what R is again?
So, I don't want to count all the preferences of all the doctors here, right? They're random. So R is, when I apply, I'm going to allow some adversarial rejections. Maybe I'm supposed to be getting to that hospital, but maybe that hospital potentially got some other applications from other people. I don't know who they are, and I'm going to allow this. So I'm going to do kind of a worst case, not average or worst case, it's in between that. But, so I'm just going to add, these are going to simulate the process that there's other people applying in the system. So basically this is going to be the union of, in this influence tree, I'm going to also allow R minus one rejection, and R up to R rejections. Okay? Okay. So this is the idea, to simulate rejections that could have possibly been, because I don't want, all the preferences are random. Okay, so what we show is that the important lemma is that with high probability, the coupled graph is elastic. Okay, when we use this number of adversarial. Okay, and the important, probably the most important lemma is this, that says for this amount of rejections, you actually capture what happens in practice. Okay, or conservative enough for what happened. Okay, that the inference tree is big enough to capture what's going on.
So you have sort of two definitions of the couple's graph, right? One just derived from the trees in one.
So first of all, the influence tree of each couple, who are the potential singles, the pairs of doctors and potential doctors and pairs of doctors and hospitals that I can potentially influence. Okay, and then I want to, there's a couple's graph that, there's a link from a couple to a different couple. So let's go to this definition here. So here, HD is this influence tree. If couple I, when it applies, it can potentially reject D from hospital H. Okay? So you have this definition only for couples, separate, but now to interact between couples, I'm looking at the preferences of hospitals. And this will give me who I want to apply first, CI or CJ.
So you had another definition a few slides ago, which said there's an error from one couple to another if there exists a context in which that couple could predict the other one.
I didn't define it. This is now how I define it.
Okay.
I was saying so before that intuitively, if there's a potential chain that I'm going to reject, right? and this is how I build it. Okay, so this is the positive result. The negative result is that if you have a linear number of couples, you cannot get with constant probability, you cannot get a stable match. And basically, what we do is create a small submarket with no stable outcome. In our example, in the proof, we have just a couple and four singles and four hospitals, so something of that size. And what we do is that we saw that with constant probability, there's not going to be a stable matching in this submarket if everybody else didn't exist. Okay, and then we're looking at a kind of a pessimistic deferred acceptance algorithm that nobody else would touch them with constant probability. That submarket, and that's how we get it. So this result is giving just a small submarket. Whether there exists a significant submarket without a stable match, I believe it's true, but it's kind of hard because we don't know how to do this. But I believe it's true. So here's some results from the psychology market that we had. I don't know why it's pretty impossible to get. Yes.
Sure. So basically, with the rules, any two people can be couples. So basically, the number of couples is basically the market selects the number of couples. In some sense, if you think that the doctors are strategizing and they compare for other people, so in some sense, if you suppose that there are the number of true couples is relatively small, then basically there's no incentive for the players to strategize to form a linear number of couples, because then there would not be a stable matching.
If they care about? So what do you mean, the market?
The people decide.
If they're going to be a couple or not.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
So,
we're not talking about this here, but
in those cases, an optimal number of couples, and if the number of true couples is less than
what optimal to get what? What do you mean by optimal?
Given that you know that there is a certain number of couples with which stable matches will still be formed, and if the number of true couples is less than that number, then there may exist a strategic reason for two people to pair as a couple, for them to be able to take advantage of the fact that couple matching happens in a different way.
So in a finite market, you can find a situation that, yeah, it's better to be a couple. But here, I believe you can show that in this setting, that two singles will not be able to manipulate as a couple. Whether this is whole group strategy proof, we didn't work this out. I don't know. It's a good question. But I think for just two singles, but it's something still interesting to show for me. That's my guess. Yeah.
Is there any way for an adversarial couple to have the knowledge of the hospital's rankings to force there to not be a stable match?
For a couple.
Or two couples or something.
I don't know the answer to it. No, so for under these, so what you will get here is with high probability, you'll get the stable match with respect to, yes, so you can't really do it. But, this result actually tells you that you can, because it's truthful also to report. It gives you a stable match with probability one.
Force the stable matching to fail rather than to optimize that relative.
You mean that caused the algorithm to fail? So with high probability, then I'm going to be able to do this. This is what the result tells me. So, yes?
So in your method, the second one, it was not that minimum alpha is smaller?
The what?
The alpha, that you said it's smaller than number.
It's a constant fraction. Yes, for any alpha. But in practice, I would say, I'll give some simulation results and maybe it will give some idea. But for any alpha, this is going to, you can prove theoretically.
And do you have any idea of which category the market was stable in this alpha and for more of the Western scale? So you have one market where.
If it grows faster, if the number of couples grow faster than the number of singles, faster, then that's what we get. Then you get a positive statement. But here, you can start. I think it will be interesting to try and to see the convergence and to maybe improve the convergence. But in this case, yeah, this is a fatal. And the reason basically is that, you get. The proof is really, it's pretty simple actually. We construct this small market with a no stable matching. And it turns out that, for example, If hospitals think about if doctors' preferences are short, they're just constant length, then it's very easy to prove. Because then they'll never touch this, they're never going to touch this small submarket that we created now. If doctors' preferences are long, it's a little bit more tricky, and then we construct like this pessimistic deferred acceptance that they really try to apply for every possible thing, and they never touch it. But then the proof is a bit more complicated. By the way, we also need here the large enough, the lambda. We didn't talk about this. That's the extra number of slots, the extra fraction of slots. If the doctor's preferences are short, are constant length, we don't need this. We need for any lambda, but when they're long, we need the large lambda. I don't think that it's true for. I think it still holds for any lambda, but it's still an interesting problem. So here's some data from results from the psychology market that we managed to get. For some reason, for the NRMP, it's impossible to get data. I don't know why. It's impossible. It's hard to get data from anywhere. So we have 3,000 doctors only and 20 couples, so it's not much. And these are the years that they operated. In practice, there was one failure, when we ran SODA on this, there was one failure of there was one year that there was not a stable match, and that was the case that there was a cycle doing this chain and kicking itself. Okay, and we were actually. Okay, so. So what we did in some experiments, we actually created, to make the larger market of the couples side more thick, we created synthetic couples using singles. So we just randomized between singles that had cared about similar geographical areas and made them a couple and aggregated their preferences somehow in the most simple way. Okay, so here's the couples graph, for example, the real couple before the 160 pairs, just how they look like with the 20 pairs. These are the couples graph, and you see this is the year that there was the one that evicted itself. But the other ones, you see that in practice there are links. So we do there is influences between couples to others, but there's no cycles. Okay. Here's some simulation results with those extra 160 couples, and you see here this is the number of doctors in the market, and this is the percentage of doctors that that participate as couples. So you can look at this as a kind of a conjecture that the number of that this probability for success is constant. When the fraction of couples is constant. Okay, I don't know if it's true, if you can really get this conjecture from this picture, but I think I would guess, my very rough guess would be that from some place it's converging to a constant. Yes?
So like 2007 shows us that we can't get strategy improvements for sure, even in practice. So you might have to sacrifice some of that. So like what do you or others propose as like the right compromise of how to deal with those cases where there's such a cycle?
When there's a cycle. In practice, they break the cycle randomly and just put one and they let the others continue to apply. So that's what happens. But till now in the NRMP, they didn't have this issue. And that's why I think that it's also interesting to go to, just to be sure, to look for other preferences, not just random ones.
As a follow-up on that, do you know how correlated the reported preferences were for the doctors in this data set?
So we didn't look too much into that, but at least for couples there are. So you're talking about the couples ones.
I was just curious in general, because that could all the individuals correlation could also.
That would be interesting to look at. We have the data, and it's a good project to look at. Yeah. So here, this is with the extra 160 couples. There's another graph that I don't have here that I don't know why, but when we had the epsilon, so the number of couples is n to the 1 minus epsilon, and you see somehow it's missing, but you see that the graphs looks like this. It goes very quickly and converges to one. So this is the probability of success, and this is the size of the market, and this is some n to the 1 minus epsilon, and they go very quickly to one. And at least for the size of the parameters for this market, it's we're around 97%. So what happens now, again, is they just break the cycle, if there is a cycle in other markets, and just go on. But this, so for example, here, this is actually the SODA algorithm what we found in the SODA algorithm, and what we tried to do is to let one of the, there's a cycle that involves also a single inside. Of course, it doesn't reject itself directly. So we let one of the singles to keep on applying down the list, and we actually found the single match in this case. But it can be a fatal problem. And yeah. So I have just a bit, 15 minutes left. I just wanted to say one more thing, going back to, so this was the stable matchings and couples. And I talked about stability and efficiency, that there's no always a stable matching that is efficient because there might be stable improvement cycles. And I talked about that sometimes in schools, for example, they just give you priority. They're just assigned priorities. They don't really have preferences over the students. Okay? And then you can think of that as just assignment mechanism. You're just assigning an object. You get assigned an object. So those schools are just objects now, and students have preferences over those objects. Okay? So you're trying to get an object, and then there's a literature, I'll just say in a few words, I won't get into this, of assignment mechanism that I think is also fascinating. It's like one-sided matching. And probably most of you heard about the top trading cycles is one way to assign objects to people. So there's a bunch of people who each have preference lists or strict preference lists over items. And one way to assign it is using the top trading cycles by Gale. I think it's just Gale, it's not Shapley. That's a mistake. And the idea is the following. Everybody points to his first preference, and you look at the graph that is constructed by these pointing, and there's going to be a cycle definitely because there's a finite number of people and objects. There's going to be a cycle, and everybody in that cycle is getting what he pointed to, and they are taken out, and then you point to the next your next point if you're still left in, and you look for another cycle, and you're taken out, and so forth. So everybody eventually will be assigned some item. Okay, suppose there's n items and n people. And this is how this algorithm works. And it turns out it's also strategy proof to report your true preferences. Yes?
Isn't this due to Shapley's curve?
On an ID of Gale.
It is.
The paper is Shapley's curve.
But I think it's Gale that came
right,
up with
they
this.
They say in the paper, due to an ID, I mean, it's an ID by Gale, and then they actually. Okay.
And then there's other ways to, there's this random serial dictatorship algorithm that is, you want all the objects, and I randomize between you who's going to choose first, and that's how you choose. So the first one is going to choose what he wants the most, and the second one is going to choose from what is left, and so forth. So that's another interesting algorithm. The probabilistic serial dictatorship by Moulin here and Anna, which is basically another way, it's sometimes called an eating algorithm. So everyone is, everyone has their preferences, okay? And so suppose there are three people, and A and one prefers object A, B then B and then C. He prefers A, B and C, and he prefers B, A, C, something like that. Okay. So what when we did the random serial dictatorship, basically every one of you is assigned a probability of to get an item eventually. Okay. So you're gonna get we randomize priority, so I can calculate what's the probability that you get each item. So what we're going to do here is also assign probabilities in the following way. So 1 and 2 prefer A, so they're going to start eating from the object A in the same pace, and 3 is going to eat from object B in the same pace, so they're going to eat probabilities. So by after half unit of time, A is going to be split it between 1 and 2, each with probability half. And B is going to be eaten by 3, half of it. And at that point, 1 and 2 are going to join 3 to eat the rest of the half. So you're basically everyone is eating in the same speed probabilities from those items together. And eventually, this will each item will be allocated with probability 1, and each person is going to be get an item with probability 1. Okay, so it's a very nice algorithm, and here's some theorems that I think worth mentioning. Mentioned that top trading cycle is strategy proof and ex post efficient, and then this part of this literature started from is also motivated by the fact that in those school choice mechanisms, we assign priority to the school. How to assign them is a really emotional thing for parents. Should we assign the same priority to each school, so over students, or should we have for each school to have a different priority over students, and so forth? So this kind of literature is coming from that, and both. So there's missing a name here. It's also, this is Abdi Kadiroglu and Solomon started this literature, and they showed that top rating cycles and random serial dictatorship are equivalent. Then Patak and Saturaman continued that and showed that a bigger family that of mechanisms that you can define that are very similar are equivalent in the sense that you get the same probabilities, the same probability outcome, same probability matrix. Okay, and Gabriel here, who actually unified all of this and has beautiful proofs, I recommend looking at that for much more general mechanisms that are equivalent. And Saturaman can continue this, and the work by Moulin is showing that this probabilistic serial is not equivalent. They're not showing that it's not equivalent. They actually are, but it's not strategy proof, but it's what's called ordinally efficient. So those other mechanisms are ex post efficient, and this one basically stochastically dominates those. So you can come up with, when you do those eating things, you can come up with situations that when you do it in a random serial dictatorship way, you can come up with probabilities that people will want to trade probabilities after the probabilities are assigned. But the probabilistic serial, no one will want to trade probabilities before the actual lotteries happen. So, but in large market, it turns out that those two mechanisms are, the probabilistic serial and the random serial dictatorship are equivalent. They give the same outcome. Okay, so I think, and there's still interesting open problems here, and I guess Gabriel will be someone to ask about this, but I think it's a fascinating literature. So again, it's really motivated by practical problems of what can we do? Should we stay just with those ex post efficient ones? Can we do better and things like that? Okay.
Questions for Itzhak?
Yeah.
So I guess I was thinking there might be situations that would not be considered stable, but which you kind of see happen and make some sense. So in a case like if you had two couples, one very strong and one, you know, one couple is one very strong and one very weak, and the other one very weak and one very strong. Like the two hospitals might in some ways be better off like knowing that they could, I'm sorry, matching those two couples might depend on each other, right? So there might be a sense that it'll be stable conditioned on the fact that the hospitals realize that if they were to unravel that, they would all be worse off, right?
If they're unraveled, they would be worse off or be?
Yeah, so, I'm sorry. So.
If several couples together, maybe.
Yeah. So
but
so
one
so
couple, no.
I mean, if you had like one couple, but one very strong, one very weak, right?
Yeah.
And this one's institution one, and this one wants to go to institution two. And you had another couple, one very weak wants to go to institution one, and one very strong wants to go to institution two. In some ways, if you were to couple those two couples together, right, pair them up, that might be the attractive option, university one and two. But it might be that in the kind of stability we have here, that situation would unravel because the weak, in both cases, neither university would want the weak spouse by themselves, and instead would prefer some single, right? But conditioned on the fact that the two couples only match because they're paired, right? Then it would be stable.
So you're going to group incentives and things like that, like two couples and things.
I feel like you actually see this like in academic markets sometimes,
yeah.
Right?
We do.
Well,
yeah.
I mean, certainly in some of the academic markets, there's transfer, right? Department A will pay a little money for, to Department B for matching. But you could have that transfer equally well by the two departments accepting, I mean, you could do it without money if the other department accepted a couple with opposite strengths, right? Where
so there's questions here that are interesting. Should like small, not small, so universities in more isolated places, should they give, what should they do? Should they give some special treatment to couples or not? Eva could maybe say what they're doing, I don't know. But, those multiple couples things, I don't have good answers to this. There's something to study. I talked about just incentives of the singles and the couples, but not as groups or the hospital.
Yeah. I can answer that part of the question if you want. Actually, employees, you better favor the couples because otherwise no one's left. It's easy in big cities that your partner can work someplace else. But if you're in the middle of nowhere...
Then you prefer couples or prefer...
Well, I like singles, but if you don't...
But they're going to move.
...couples, you simply don't use no employees.
Exactly.
They're not enough of the singles around, sorry.
It's not about the other singles around, that's the problem.
You have some number of jobs, and if you only offer them to singles, then there are not enough applicants left.
Yeah. Ah, okay. Yeah?
So one thing that we've taken is fixed through, most of this is sort of like, either someone already knows their preferences, and maybe we randomize over the other things. Do we, or can you talk a little about models which sort of both do the matching and try to unify it with discovery? So for like with medical match, right, there's some process by which interviews occur and hospitals form their preferences.
So this literature on search, I think, so you mean when I reveal my preference?
Or yeah, it might be some sort of search by which maybe it's matching for the interviews themselves, and then what you learn of that is input into the subsequent matching problem.
So there is some research literature that happens over dynamic time that you're applying and then you're applying to some other place. I can't tell you much about that. There's a recent work from a computer scientist by Nicole Molita and Kevin Layton Brown, and I don't remember all the names, there's a bunch, about interviews. So when you interview, you reveal something about they're doing kind of price of anarchy results. Yeah, so I would go to the search literature, but I cannot say much about it.
Yeah. So in the group that you showed that probability one will eventually reach a situation where we will not have any incentive coupled up. The important bit was you get that the chance that one couple affects another becomes 1 over n. In that, I'm just trying to, couldn't you also reach the same result without imposing independence on everyone? As long as you just have independence between couples, would you still get the same 1 over n chance of a couple affecting any other couple? So people in a couple could have correlated preferences, and you would still probably get the same outcome.
So that would be a nice result. I don't know how to say if it's true, but that would be a nice result. That's something to definitely do. Right now, what we do is randomize for each member separately, and then aggregate any way you want. Maybe those, if you randomized in some of the hospitals in California, but it has to respect the order that we draw. So, but that direction, I'm not sure. I can't say that's true. I think it's true. Yeah.
Is there a good reason why we don't allow money for the National Reference Matching Program? So there was a court case against the NRM.
That's right.
Years ago.
And there's a good reason. I've also a series of papers about one complaining that money, without money, it harms the student. And then there was a paper that there's an example by Kojima that doesn't harm the student. And then there was another paper that. So that's a good question. I would look at those papers and see, maybe they get convinced from the models, but each one of them is just giving a market with monetary values, and another one is giving an example why they are wrong. So
So is there a consensus among
There's national? No, right now there's a consensus to stay without money and, yeah. So the claim was that it harms the doctors that they get less money eventually. There's no consensus about this. Okay.